can't see any obstacles now.
Good evening. Welcome to the Crucible Theatre. They say that every underdog has its day, and Glasgow's Graham Dott is hoping that this year it'll be his turn. Yes, we've got a 200-to-1 outsider against a red-hot favourite, Rocket Ronnie O'Sullivan, in the final of this year's Embassy World Championship. It's a lineup that very few of us could have predicted at the end of a 16-day Crucible stint that's been full of surprises.
Well, before the event started, everybody said it was going to be the most open tournament ever, and in some ways, that's how it's turned out.
Absolutely right. I mean, we couldn't pick a winner, and we've seen with the results that maybe the top four who used to be a lot clear of the others, maybe they're not anymore.
Jimmy White came into the tournament having just won the last. Everybody thought it may be his year.
And then all of a sudden, he's blown away straight out in the first round. He's got to wait for another year.
Mark Williams' timing wasn't so good, was it?
He needs to get that better, doesn't he, really? When having the birth of his son the day before he's playing his match. Not good, Mark. Try and do it better next time.
And of course, highlight for many, Quinton Han against Andy Hicks. I mean, you're bald, you're short, and I'll have you outside.
Marvellous. He came here looking for a fight on the table, and he's got one in the ring when he's left.
June the 11th, we can't wait.
Mark King for me, though. I think he'll duff him up.
Essex for us.
Ronnie's antics earlier in the week. Looked like he was huffing and puffing, smashed the table, a few gestures, didn't look happy. Improved through the tournament, though.
Caused the people behind the scenes a few problems early on. Now they're all just raving about him.
And of course, Stephen Hendry, the record defeat at the Crucible, 17-4 in the semi-final. Who could have thought of that one?
Stephen was very gracious in defeat, and I'm not too sure it's going to have too much of an effect on his career. If it had happened earlier in his career, perhaps, but now Stephen's he's quite philosophical about things.
And what about the surprise package of the entire tournament? It's got to be Graham Dott.
Well, good things come in little packages.
The two finalists will emerge from their dressing rooms any minute now. They've had 2.25 hours to fill since the afternoon session finished. How many Ronnie will win by was the pre-final chat, but Graham Dott is winning over fans to his side. The young Scot was thinking of a career change earlier this year. He was totally disillusioned, couldn't pot a ball, smashed up his cue. 4 months later, he's playing in the World Championship final.
Anybody. That's actually the main reason why I broke the queue. And I think my next match I was to play was in a ranked tournament, was Drew Henry, but I mean, I couldn't beat Lenny Henry the way I was playing. And when I broke the queue, I just thought, there's no way I'm going to win a match. So you'd never believe I could get through this.
There's no favourites, it's the final. You know, it's like Wimbledon, you know, winning the FA Cup, you know. There's no favourites when you get to that far. It's 90 minutes of football, it's 2 days of snooker, and a lot is riding on it, and I think it's going to see who handles the pressure the best.
The knock on the dressing room doors confirms the players will be out very, very shortly. And as they prepare to make their entrances, all the best to Ronnie. As they prepare to make their entrances to the table, let's look at some contrasting facts and figures on Ronnie and Graham.
This is how that first session story unfolded. If anyone was suffering from big match nerves, it was Ronnie O'Sullivan. This miss in the first let in Dot, and he just couldn't stop potting. The Scot was quite magnificent as he took the first four frames of the match, turning the form book squarely on its head and sending Ronnie into the mid-session interval to think again. After the break, Dot then took the fifth to make it 5-0 before Ronnie finally found his rhythm. A century break and the Rocket was on the board at 5-1. A series of misses in the seventh cost Dot dearly as O'Sullivan made it 5-2. Then a sign that perhaps the tide was turning. A fluke by Ronnie in the last of the session helped him to reduce the deficit further. 5-3 and intriguingly poised. Yes, it really is a David and Goliath contest, isn't it? I'm not sure whether Graham's brought his slingshot tonight, but I know that both players are certainly aiming to bring their best form into the auditorium. Graham's here, already incorrect. Good luck to Graham, and of course Ronnie's just waiting behind there in the wings. Good luck to Ronnie as well. So, let's get them out there and let's introduce them. And it's MC Alan Hughes, best in the business, who'll do the honours.
Ladies and gentlemen, now to the players. And first we welcome a terrific match player who never knows how to lay down. And time again in this tournament, he's battled through thick and thin. And no one can deny him the chance to win the Embassy World Crown. Can I ask you to welcome, please, Graham Dot. And ladies and gentlemen, his opponent, so classy and unbeatable when the mood takes, and the former Embassy World Champion, starts next season as the world's number one player. Will you welcome into the Crucible Arena the most gifted player the game has ever produced, Ronnie O'Sullivan.
What a welcome for both players. Here we go, second session of a possible four. It's best of 35 frames, remember. And teaming up in the commentary box tonight, we say good evening to Clive Everton and Dennis Taylor.
Good evening, Hazel. Good evening, everyone. Great occasion, great atmosphere.
Thank you, frame 9. Ronnie O'Sullivan to break.
Very good break off from Ronnie O'Sullivan. Covered both reds. One to the right of the pack, one to the left. Needs to catch this one a little bit on the thin side. Well, he's decided to leave the white up this end.
That's because Dot was nervous of O'Sullivan's long potting. He didn't want to leave the red right of picture to right corner. I've seen Graham Dot play a lot in the last 10 years, and I've never seen him sustain such a high standard for so long as he did in the first five frames this afternoon.
Well, he's a long way off that one. Yes, he shocked everyone in that opening. And I think he probably gave Ronnie O'Sullivan two or three chances. He just never put a foot wrong, Graham.
One.
But new session, new start. And O'Sullivan will want to start sharply and build up some momentum.
Ramble. Ronnie O'Sullivan, one.
He won't leave a great deal if he just nestles in the red. That one to the left of the pack is not going to be easy. He's played it well.
Touch in ball, both reds.
He had to be very precise with that. Had he have slipped off the reds, he would have left that one to the middle pocket, and as you can see, the blue would have been available. Black out of commission at the moment. But the thing about Ronnie, when he was 5-0 down, Clive, he still looked very relaxed out there, and when he won his first frame, there was a little smile on his face as he left the arena, so he certainly kept his temperament.
You couldn't tell the way he made that century to get off the mark, whether he was 5-0 down or 5-0 up, it just didn't seem to affect him at all. O'Sullivan actually said after his semi-final, what is pressure? It's only something you create in your own mind.
Too thin. That's why the red's gone over the corner pocket.
Yeah, sure.
Ronnie can take this red on, and he could stun round the back of the black and red. That's the sort of angle he can make from that. I can't see him wanting to cannon into the red next to the black. That would be too risky. All depends on the angle he has on this red at the back of the bunch. There you can see, no way he can develop the black.
Six.
Paul Collier doing his first ever Embassy World Final. Good referee.
Seven.
And at the age of 33, the youngest ever World Final referee.
Well, that wobbled a little bit, but safely in the end.
12.
Let's have a look at this. Any harder, the pocket would have thrown it out.
13.
There's nobody better than O'Sullivan in developing breaks from unpromising positions. Black tied up, pink will go to the left middle.
18.
From there.
Yes, Clive, he's got such a quick brain. He sees all the shots well in advance. And once again, that left hand 19. Proving so useful. In between sessions this afternoon, he was on the practice table, actually practicing left-handed.
Pink going on the highest available spot because its own spot is occupied.
26.
Once again, it's a bit of a stretch to play the pink left-handed. Blue's very awkward. Now this is some shot, especially with how far he's stretching.
29.
Crucible crowd appreciating that. So Ronnie's brilliant right-handed, he's brilliant left-handed, and he's pretty good with the rest. Tough to beat, eh?
30.
Already 38 in front. Now, is the black spot available? Paul Collier just using a ball marker there, which will tell him. Just enough room.
37.
Mustn't be touching the red. But I think he'll just concentrate
38.
On the blue and try and clinch the frame with reds and blues.
43. 44.
Now just watch this next shot. He's got to screw back because he looks to be fairly straight.
49.
And he plays this type of shot effortlessly.
Yes, he doesn't bang it. The secret of getting the spin, getting the cue ball to recoil, is getting the cue through the cue ball with maximum acceleration.
50.
Just needed another couple of inches up the table. Looks to be fairly straight on the blue. Hasn't done anything wrong here.
65.
This needs a good shot to swing the white past that
55.
Red and back round for the blue again. He needs to be very precise with this.
56.
He obviously couldn't take that shot on, but it was going to be difficult if he was trying to develop the black, but he's got that 57 point advantage.
Green ball.
Only 59 on the table.
Ronnie O'Sullivan, 56.
With that last shot, Dennis, some players would have taken care to put a colour safe.
I think he might have hit the green on the wrong side. I'm sure he would have tried to push the green safe. Yeah, this is the shot you were talking about, Clive. Ronnie, if he pushes the green onto the cushion, he's got a chance of getting the snooker. I think he just possibly hit it on the wrong side there.
Dot makes an unintended contact on a second red. That red would have left Dot needing a snooker.
Well, Graham needs the black into play. This is a tough situation, because he can't just run off the reds here and go up to the safety zone because of the red next to the yellow and pink. He's just playing this halfway up the table, I feel. He's put himself in trouble. He's come too far up. Ronnie will snooker him now, send the red back up the table.
With yellow and pink where they are, O'Sullivan effectively has three ball widths to hide the cue ball behind.
Well, he could have played it better. There might be a little bit of this red sticking out, the one to the left. If not directly, catch it coming back, but he seems to be playing with a little touch of swerve. Doesn't want to hit it more than, I was just going to say, I thought he didn't want to hit it more than half ball. He might just be okay, but I think this one behind the black goes. Graham shot on that last effort, Clive. He'd have been better maybe just hitting the top cushion first and then sliding off
six.
The red. When he played the swerve shot, it looked like he was always going to leave
seven.
One on.
So O'Sullivan is at the winning post in the opening frame without Dot potting a ball.
12.
Right-handed, left-handed.
Well, the pattern of the match, Clive, 5
20.
To Graham Dot, and it's going to be 4 to Ronnie O'Sullivan.
21.
O'Sullivan was 5-0 down, but won the last three frames of the afternoon. And now the first of the evening to reduce Dot's lead to 5-4.
It's getting close again. And Stephen, John, how important for Ronnie to maintain the momentum from the last session there?
I think it was important to some degree because he'd showed some great form in getting back in the first session and had the competitive momentum by the end of that session, but it could have been a turn with the interval, and all of a sudden Ronnie's come out in the same shape as he was at the end of the session, and he did it in some style there.
He did too, yeah. What's all this doing to Graham? Because he hasn't really felt a lot of pressure so far in this match, ironically, John.
No, he hasn't, and the interesting thing in his other matches, when he's been pressed and they've come, other players have come close, gone away again, but this is a different type of thing. I mean, he's been 5-0 up in this, 5-1, 5-2, 5-3, now it's 5-4. He's got to be feeling something, Hazel.
But In saying that, John, what's impressed us, I think, in the last couple of matches from Graham's perspective is that every time players have come back at him, for example, Matthew Stevens, he seemed to have found something within himself to go ahead again.
He has indeed, but the thing with this fella is you've got to keep him off the table. I mean, Ronnie, there's he can win frames in no time at all, so it's important that he keeps his safety good.
OK, let's get back out there.
I like that view of the table. It shows how long it is. Sometimes you get a foreshortening effect on some camera angles, which makes long pots appear a little easier.
Frame 10, Graham Dott to break.
Than they in fact are.
Just having a look, but if he pots this one to the left corner, the path round the back of the black is not available because of the red that's near the cushion. So if he takes the pot on, it's a little bit risky as to what will happen with the cue ball. If he plays it playing ball to pot that one, that's the natural angle, is to go into that red, so he's going to have to do something with the white here if he takes that on. In fact, he's refusing it quite rightly, and he hasn't taken any liberties in this final, Clive, nor the semi-final.
He's been very disciplined but deadly, and he's got in. Back to Bourque, and not easy to pick out a containing safety.
Yes, normally when you're in this situation you'd come off the side cushion into the pack, but look at the reds either side of it, so that's not available either. There might be a path around the back of the black if he takes this pot on.
Great pot. Forced into it because there was no alternative.
This is tough because he's got to get back up to near the blue spot with the white here if he pots the yellow. He's played it well. Got the red to the right corner, and he can drop onto the black here.
Dott explained after his semi-final what he was trying to do in terms of mental attitude, and he used a famous Steve Davis dictum: try to play as if it means nothing when it means everything.
Graham showed how he can cope with the pressure situation in his semi-final against Matthew Stevens. He led 10-7, and Matthew won
11.
Four frames in a row with 270s, a 90 and a century. And then Graham came back again, Clive, so he can do it under pressure.
Well, he's
12.
Thank you.
16.
Dot's had help recently from Del Hill, a coach who's helped various players on the circuit.
Yes, quite a 17. Tall coach. Clive, he's bigger than you. He's about 6 foot nine, I think, is Del.
That's when he stood up, of course.
Yeah, sure. 24.
I think he's got a bit of angle on this red. Maybe a slightly heavy contact there, but he doesn't have to go into the pack yet. There's one at the back of the pack that may be on for the opposite corner. But he's got a little bit of angle to work with, so he should be able to get out nicely onto the black. 25. Thought he'd missed it.
25.
Just watch Graham's reaction. He thought it was going on the near knuckle. He hasn't quite got the angle to screw over behind the pack to leave the red into the right corner, so he's going to have to go into them here. He did well. It weren't a great pack to go into there. The only problem with this pot, it looks as if he's going to cannon the red, so he'll have to make sure he gets the correct contact to stay on the black. That was always going to be the problem there.
33. Yellow ball. Graham Dot, 33.
As he has so often in this championship, Dot was hoping to respond there after his opponent had taken a run of frames.
But what he does, Clive, if he does break down, he doesn't give any expression. He just gets down and plays the safety shot. So he doesn't get himself upset if he does make a mistake.
And O'Sullivan's long red having failed, Dot is still 33 ahead.
He can have a go at this, you know. Well, he didn't play the plant. Yeah, I thought there was a possibility he could have taken that up into the corner and played for the black, because he wouldn't have left anything. He's got a good cue ball here. And psychologically, this is a big frame for Graham Dot, I feel, Clive, having lost the last four. If he could win this one, big boost to his confidence again.
If he doesn't, that great start, 5-0, is negated.
That's superb.
Inch perfect. Tried to play that little roll up in such a way that it wouldn't be that easy for O'Sullivan to get the cue ball behind the black, but he can just roll it to the cushion. Maybe he overplayed that. He certainly didn't mean to cannon the black.
Yeah, just a slight misjudgment. And Graham might just be tempted here to take this to the middle pocket. He can quite easily screw back in behind the black. Where's the red coming? How far up the table is this red coming? Bit unlucky. I think he was hoping the red might have hit the blue. Looks as if he's going to have to roll to them again. No other shot available.
Almost always
touching ball.
A short-term solution, that, because you're going to be put back in a very similar position next shot.
I think he's having a little sing to himself there. It'll be a little Scottish number, I feel. They've got to be so proud of this young man in Scotland.
Only the third Scot ever to play in an Embassy World Championship final, after Stephen Hendry and John Higgins. Although, of course, in an earlier generation, a much earlier generation, Walter Donaldson brought the world title back to Scotland in 1947 and 1950.
Ronnie would be trying to get behind the black tight on this back cushion. And he's far enough off the cushion this time to screw the white back. There's a red that'll go up into the corner, but might just have a go at it because he's screwing back. What about that one?
One.
O'Sullivan's safety, just a shade slack, but great shot from Dot, all the same. Cue pointing downwards, had to bump it. Very encouraging for him.
Eight.
Pretty good shape now. There's a couple of reds up to the left of the blue that are potable.
Nine.
Still got the one in the middle of the table.
Dot hasn't won all that many frames in a single visit throughout this championship. But in a way, this is shaping up like a typical Dot frame. A useful break for starters, in this case 33. Then he's hung on in a safety duel
and then 12.
Got in again and the position
13.
Holds the potential for him to go two clear at 6-4.
Seventeen.
Well, he's 50 points of difference. So he's got the two reds up there. If he can get to 60 in front, there would only be 59 left on the table. So he can clinch this frame without needing one of the difficult reds. Well, maybe the pink is available. It looks as if it's tied up, but maybe there's just enough room, but... Well, he's going to have to go into the red, so... I thought he might have played red, brown, red, brown, and Ronnie would have needed a snooker.
He's got slightly hampered cueing. One aspect of which was that he was bridging longer than he would normally like.
24.
Another great performance from Graham Dott to take this frame. He only needs the pink. 25. Well, why has he hit it so hard? He only
Graham
needs
Dott,
the pink.
25.
Oh, if he loses the frame now, he'll have a job to forget that. The pink would have put him...
Settle down, please.
64 in front. With only 59 on.
Well, the way he was pointing there, it was as if he got a heavy contact, because can't see why he should miss an easy pot like that.
Yeah, sure.
It's very difficult to detect if you get a bad contact when you hit the ball so hard, but let's have a look. Seemed to jump a little touch.
Even so, part of the explanation may have been that he was trying to force a slight angle instead of making sure of what was effectively frame ball. If he pots this red, it won't matter. Didn't let it upset him.
One. Graham Dott won, and the frame.
So, Graham Dott, after a four-frame losing streak, goes two ahead once more. He leads by 6-4. Graham Dott said after his semi-final, Ronnie O'Sullivan has beaten Anthony Hamilton 13-3, Stephen Hendry 17-4. What chance have I got? Well, the answer so far would be a better chance than anybody thought.
Okay. Frame 11, Ronnie O'Sullivan to break.
Another good break-off shot from Ronnie. See Ronnie's intention there. He wanted that black cleared, and he's played a good shot. Yellow and brown are quite a good target now to get in behind. Ronnie's just had a look to see if he's going to push a red towards the corner, but he'd be trying to get in behind yellow and brown here.
Not quite.
That's the snooker. Ronnie's a great tactical player, isn't he? And talking about tactical players, one of the greatest is sitting on the right there, the six-time Embassy World Champion, Ray Reardon, one of the best tacticians the game's ever seen.
Fortunate in the end not to leave the red that he struck.
Well controlled that. He had to play that with a lot of side to avoid the cannon. Now just watch this shot that Ronnie played there. The natural shot would have taken him into the black. He played it with lots of side and top spin. But he's left a half chance here. And he's taken it.
One.
And now Ronnie has opened the table up. Just look at the way the balls are situated. And that good pot has given Graham Dott the chance here. He's knocked quite a lot of those in, hasn't he, Clive, in this final?
He's been very solid all round. Potted well from distance. Very good safety. Hasn't won a lot of frames in a single scoring visit. Maybe this will be an exception.
Four.
Because with the balls spread as they are, if you do break down, then you're vulnerable to a counter-attack.
5.
The pink's out of the game at the moment. The black's okay. He's got an angle on the blue here. I'm wondering if he might risk a cannon onto the pink to develop it, because that would hold him there, and he's bound to finish on a red. Because he can screw past the red that's near the blue and touch the pink just. It's finished a little awkward, especially if the pink doesn't go in the corner because he's hampered. But that was worth the risk.
Ten.
Just didn't get the cannon as he intended.
Got the cannon just as intended, but this is quite tricky. Not so bad, this sort of shot, if you can just drop it in. And perhaps he was wise there, not to be too ambitious. Just drop it in and play from near the cushion.
This is the shot here, though. He's got to avoid the cannon on the green to get back up to the reds when he puts this blue. And he's done that. He's played that well.
Sixteen.
Just a little bit too much pace. He's still got an alternate to the right corner. Was hoping to be straight on that one next to the blue. He's got to force the blue again to get back up at least to the middle of the table to leave that red that's next to blue and white there. But he's got plenty of cue power, has Graham Dott.
Who revealed the other evening that his cue is probably the shortest on the circuit. The story of him snapping his old cue is well known now. He certainly seems to have taken to the new one.
Clive, do you remember who used to use the shortest cue on the circuit? Jackie Ray, the great Jackie Ray, who was Irish champion and played against the great Joe Davis, Fred Davis. He was a smashing little player, great entertainer. 29. He knows he's tying the black up when he pots it here, when it's re-spotted. He's got a problem now, because he can't get onto the pink.
36.
Unless the red that's to the left of the white is on for the middle, but it looks too close. And this red into the right corner. I don't know if he can pot that red and swing it past the reds to get around the table, because the pink's not available, so he's got a bit of a problem here, depending on the angle he has on this.
Sure.
There's the angle, he can't drop it in and leave the pink to the middle. Might have to play with a lot of screw to go off the side cushion and back over again. Because I don't think the angle's on to swing it around the reds. Played it well. Did you see the white come off the cushion with the side there?
Yes, that was right of centre striking as he looked at it.
He's having to work so hard for these, he can't get himself into the ideal position.
42.
On the previous shot, had he have been straight on the pink, he would have taken that. Got another delicate little shot to play here, to leave the pink for the left middle pocket. Can he keep this break going?
Thanks. Yeah, sure.
Would have been on pink to middle had he potted it. And further away from the side cushion because he missed it on the full side. Missed it on the near jaw. So a 42-point lead, far from decisive.
But what it does do, it puts quite a bit of pressure on Ronnie O'Sullivan. Because he knows he can't afford to miss. But now that he's knocked that red on, and he's on the pink, a chance to get right back in the frame.
Seven. Eight. 13. 14.
He's just looking to see what's available. There's one certainly will go. Well, he's in pretty good shape because all three reds will be available. It's just the one on the side cushion and the one next to the black. They're going to be the two key balls.
20.
Tried to graze the red next to the black to bring the black into play.
Shot that is. What a terrific pot on the pink.
27.
Right in the heart of the pocket from close to the cushion. And that's where I say it, Clive, his temperament is so good. He didn't get the cannon on the red next to the black, finished near the cushion. He didn't let it faze him. Well, he's developed 41. The red, but it's still pretty tough.
41.
Refused the pot.
played that well. It's a full ball snooker. Got to be a little bit careful here. Just wants to nestle onto them. Well judged.
So it's come to a dogfight with two reds left, and you would have to think that Dot's got as good a chance as O'Sullivan in this sort of situation.
That was the sort of line he was looking, but he still played a good shot there. Bit of a chance. Ronnie knows that Graham is quite capable of knocking this in, and look where the colours are. If he pots the red, you would think he'd be bound to finish on a colour. He's not going to drop on a colour, but he will with his next shot. He'll drop on the green, and Ronnie will be in all sorts of trouble.
Graham Dott's one.
OK, but if O'Sullivan wriggles out of this, then Dott has got no significant advantage from the ready potted. He would much prefer to have landed on a colour.
He's got two choices. Is he going to go two cushions? He's gone round the back of it.
Foul and a miss. Graham Dott, four.
Very, very near. And O'Sullivan hoping the pink has come to his rescue. A shot of some skill, rewarded by a considerable amount of luck not to leave that on.
Got the snooker, but Ronnie can get a bit of distance between red and white here. Oh, that's left it on, believe it or not. This is a chance. If he pots this, come round the back of the yellow here. Well, he's gone for the snooker. I thought he might try to snick that in. He potted one similar to it previously there. That's a good shot. Looks to be a snooker. And this can go anywhere. Coming off the top cushion, you never know where they're going to go. Well, he switched left-handed for some reason for this shot.
So seem to be no obvious reason for that.
Just showing us that he's not only a terrific potter with his left hand, but he's a terrific safety player. This is a bit short. Maybe just covered the potting angle. Not sure if he can get past the brown to take this on to the middle. Must be very tight. Well, maybe not just enough. You see, the green's in a good position for both players because the red anywhere over in that side of the table and it won't go past the green. It's interesting to see how Graham plays this, because if he plays off the red, there's always a chance this red could go near the opposite corner pocket. The number of times that you double that type of shot and the red goes in, because you're playing the safety shot, the red goes in, it's a bonus.
Taking advantage, first of all, of the goalkeeper, the green, up in the top right corner there.
There's some good stuff going on here, some great tactical play and safety play from both players. So who's going to make the first mistake? You'd think it would cost the frame. To get the red from behind here, you'd have to get so much side on it to try and hit the cushion first, and I don't know if it's possible. No, it wasn't. Just a little flick off the cushion, well played again. Well, there's the first mistake. Can Graham Dott capitalize on it?
Oh. That was a chance for Dott to go three frames clear. He's got second prize, but will he get another chance?
Yes, that was a golden opportunity for Graham Dott, but he's only human. He's coped well with the pressure, but a little bit of tension on that last shot. I don't think it's a snooker. You can tell by Graham's expression there. Now, Ronnie might be tempted to take this on, because look where the green is. There's no problem with getting on a colour if the red goes in.
O'Sullivan misses a possible chance to take the frame. And now he's got second prize, a snooker.
Chance for Ronnie O'Sullivan. Is this going to be a turning point in this final? Graham looked as if he was going to open up a three-frame advantage again. It could be down to just one.
One.
Will he play this left-handed?
Three.
Or can he reach it with his right? Just. It's a bit of a stretch, though. He's going to have to get that little extension. He wants to get over it near the cushion so that it leaves himself an easy shot to get from green to brown.
Five.
Just a little bit further would have been perfect.
Eight.
This should be straightforward now, but nothing's ever straightforward at the Crucible.
12.
Just blue and pink needed.
17.
Of 29 minutes duration, and
23 on the frame, Ronnie O'Sullivan.
O'Sullivan has won it to reduce his arrears to 6-5 after Dot had had a great chance to lead 7-4. Well, Dot held the initiative almost throughout that frame. He was 40 in front when he missed this. Stunning to leave pink to middle. Hit it too straight. There were quite a few skirmishes, and then near the end of the frame, he had a golden chance to clinch a 7-4 lead.
Yes, let's just watch how he cues at this here. It's a pretty straightforward pot, and it was as if he got a little touch of side on the cue ball that he didn't intend to, and really I think when he missed that clive, that was always going to be Ronnie's frame, you felt.
Yes, 6-5 then to Dot instead of the 7-4 it could so easily have been.
And perhaps we're beginning to see the first signs of real tension in our underdog here. How did you assess the second missed red that would have tied it up?
Well, it's the first shot that could sort of undermine Graham Dot's superb start and confidence. Other shots are missable, the one with the long rest, but that was missable. But that was the first shot that he would really feel distraught about missing.
Okay, well, I understand that Graham has brought a busload of supporters down from Lark Hall to watch his performance. His mum, Susan, is out there in the arena. I understand she never is able to watch him play on television, gets too nervous, but for the first time in her life, she's in the auditorium tonight watching him perform. Get that woman a brandy.
O'Sullivan has won five of the last six frames, spread over late afternoon and the early part of the evening.
In this final, Ronnie O'Sullivan hasn't played one careless shot. His shot selection has been impeccable. Well, that's not all that bad, catching the knuckle there. I don't think the two reds are a plant, because you could knock one red onto that, but I don't think they're in line for the pocket. There you see it. Well, is there one in the middle there that might just go? I do believe there is. Ronnie spotted one. I think the one in the circle there, Ronnie can get through to that. And one good positional shot here, and he can get onto the black. He doesn't have to play for the red that's next to the black just yet. But he'll be on that in a couple of shots' time, if not with this positional shot. So it's red, black, and then the red closest to the black, and that
six
clears the black spot area.
Seven.
Ray Reardon telling his colleagues just exactly what's going on.
Fifteen.
No, that's cleared the black spot area, so good chance now for Ronnie.
22.
Those little shots, he plays them so well. Delicate little screw shots and stun shots. You're watching a master at work here.
30. 31.
30. So many times O'Sullivan comes to the table with only a few reds out of the bunch, but
38.
He's a master at developing more as he goes.
He just seemed to let the white run a little bit closer to the cushion than he intended there, but still should be okay.
39.
Maybe just a little bit short. He might have to head for the blue here.
46.
And he's got a choice of reds to play on. He doesn't have to go into the pink and reds here. Well, this has been a cracking final so far. Shock 5-0 in front for Graham Dott. Ronnie coming back to take four in a row. It's good stuff.
Fifty-nine.
Still okay.
64.
Getting ready for the interval.
65.
That was amazing. He got down right-handed and then suddenly switched at the last minute.
70.
The frame in the bag, barring a snooker. And even that was assuming
71.
That he would miss that straightforward red.
78. Ronnie O'Sullivan, 78 on the frame.
And with that 78 break, Ronnie O'Sullivan levels at 6-all at the mid-session interval.
So evenly poised, we effectively start again, and it's really been the story of the traditional game of two halves so far, Steve.
It certainly has, and how quickly Ronnie O'Sullivan has got rid of that 5-0 deficit. He's made very light work of a crisis point in the match, and we said earlier that it's a sign of a great champion in adversity as well as from in front, so he's proven his worth on that count.
What do you think has been most impressive about the way Ronnie has been able to shut out that earlier part of the session?
Well, it's his happy score, and it always is, Hazel. I mean, as you say, Steve said, he's come back fairly quickly, and that's always helped by one frame, contribution in every frame being a heavy one, and that's what he's done in this, and it's very, very quickly that lead is from Graham's gone away.
Do you think that the pressure will start to build in Graham's mind now?
Well, he might sort of go, well, we're back square one again, yeah. Let's go for it. I mean, I'm enjoying myself. I mean, it's a great challenge. He's a great player. I'm going to give it another bash and see where he goes. It depends, but that red wasn't the nice red to miss over the pocket. As we mentioned, the first one that could cause a few problems for him mentally.
After all, he's already got more frames on the board than Anthony Hamilton and Stephen Hendry in the last couple of matches. It's something to be proud of right away, I suppose.
Yeah, yes, indeed. But as you say, who knows about that red the frame before? Might prey on his mind a little bit.
Okay. Now, over the last 16 days, we've had thousands of balls pocketed here, and we actually can't really keep a track of them, but I hope you'll agree with some of our shots of the championship so far.
Gone round the angles, but he's getting the same. This is a terrific shot. He finishes tight on the cushion. It's a fantastic positional shot from Barry Pinches.
Full commitment. What a shot.
That's just outrageous.
alongside all those great shots played by great players, the venue itself is a huge factor in the success of the championship. Clive Everton made the point in the commentary box this afternoon. This is snooker's Wimbledon or St Andrews. The Crucible Theatre itself is a star, as is the city of Sheffield. It always offers great support to the championship.
Snooker has been a very important part of letting Sheffield move forward. We've still got a long way to go, but as you can see, Sheffield is absolutely on the move. We're a wonderful, vibrant city, and we're actually changing all the time. So snooker is a beginning part of it. I think what was special about it that nobody actually envisaged in the beginning is the actual snooker players themselves. The snooker players themselves have been a big part of Sheffield, and they've created this wonderful partnership with us. It's like we're their second home. I think there's something special about our Sheffield's unique character that just brings the best out of all the players. You do get people in the streets actually looking at the city in a different way, and what it is, it's all about our visitors. What they'll say is, wow, Sheffield isn't the place that we thought it was. And it's another good feeling for them.
The World Snooker Championship here is absolutely invaluable to the city of Sheffield. It affects the entire supply chain throughout the whole city with the visitors that are brought in, from hotel occupancy rates rising significantly right the way through to the knock-on effect on hotel, leisure, catering, restaurateurs, and of course quite a dramatic impact on retail spend within the city as well. Probably from the research that has been conducted so far, somewhere in the region of about £2.2 million could be contributed to the city. We've been realising over the last few years just how important these championships are. It's a world championship. It puts the city on the map. So there's an element of prestige as well as what we call the financial contribution to the city. And when we've had other areas now of development, such as the Channel 4 Games coming to the city of Sheffield as well, that also helps to cement the position of Sheffield as what we call a city of sport. For many years, the city seemed to be in very much a downward slump. But the snooker championships held faith with us, we held faith with them, they're still here, we want to keep them for many years to come, and we want more events just like it.
The Snooker World Championships is very, very important to Sheffield. I think there's two things. It's not just the economy, but it's also that goodwill factor it gives people who actually live here. It's something that they look forward to. I know the players themselves look forward to coming here, and as I said earlier, people who actually visit the city like to come to Sheffield and watch it here. There's something very special about it, something that's different from all the other occasions, that's just an absolutely unique opportunity, and we really do value it in Sheffield.
Six times world champion Ray Reardon has popped out for a quick chat. First of all, Ray, Sheffield, the Crucible and the World Championship just go together perfectly, don't they?
Yes, it's been recognised now as the home of our game for many years. And when I first came here many years ago, I think it's getting more exciting, actually, with all these young lads that's coming along.
How are you enjoying this year? Because you're really giving Ronnie O'Sullivan a helping hand. What have you been saying to him?
Well, it's very difficult to say, really, because he called me to come up to lend a hand, if you like, and I saw a few things that needed sorting out, and the main thing was that we gelled together, because had he not, then I'd have gone home. But we have gelled together, and basically he's a really nice lad inside, you know, and he's so excited in there. I mean, when he was five down... Well, six all is much nicer, isn't it, really?
The fact
makes
of it
me
is,
feel better. My heart's going, my heart's moved, you know that?
Calm down, sir.
I shouldn't be here.
Down.
I'll have an heart attack doing this, you know. Mind you, I'm only 34, really. So, yeah. Born in 1842, Transylvania, you know.
Absolutely, Sir Raymond. Great memories of you playing Alex Higgins here in the final many years ago.
Many years, 1982.
I'm sure you'd be delighted that Alex is on the road to recovery after serious illness and is playing snooker.
Absolutely thrilled,
yeah.
Absolutely thrilled. And a lot of the boys are trying to help him out as best as they can.
When you look back over the history of the game, he certainly made a contribution, didn't he?
Yes, he came in the game like a breath of fresh air. He's a different style to sort of myself and others, and he came in prolific, potting balls all over the place. He had this nervous disposition, and he was twitching, and he'd bang the table before he potted the ball. It was exciting, really exciting.
Sir Raymond, lovely to be in your company. Always controversial, yeah. Alex Higgins was as brilliant round the table as he's caused a little bit of trouble. Everyone is delighted he's back playing snooker again.
Yes.
People say snooker's struggling. I'm coming here to play Alex Higgins. There's 1,400 to watch this match tonight. Preston sold out, the Pavilion sold out. So it's great, the snooker's on the up again.
If you put your best foot forward and you're given a chance, you can probably still win. And it takes a bit of determination. He's got lots of that. I've been a bit shy over the last 5 or 6 years, but I do like playing in front of a nice crowd of people, and, well, a big crowd of people. and it's extra special to play Jimmy.
He still can play. He's got to find a bit of time to practice, but these little exhibitions and a few small tournaments and warm up, and who knows? Is that it?
Yeah. No.
We're talking about maybe bringing another doubles tournament back, and if we do, I will play with Alex.
Over here. Yeah. Either in Ireland or in a greater scale, but we'd like to make it up running again. It'd be good bit of fun for the other players as well.
If you're a snooker fan, you should definitely watch the play. It's phenomenal.
Well, I mean, they appeal to people that of all walks of life, and there's a lot in the play that you can see in the snooker, and you can say, oh yeah, he did do it a bit like that.
Let's get one thing straight. I'm what I am, and I don't give a damn whether you love me or hate me. I make no excuses. I live life the only way I know how. Fast. No pause for breath. No time for reflection. A quick appraisal of the situation, and I'm in there. And I'm out again. I'm living on the hoof. Heart to trot. A rolling stone gathers no moss. Can't sit still. Never have. Never will.
There's a lot to relate, whether it be Jimmy or I, in a play about myself or a play about Jimmy, and about the ups and downs of being a snooker player, right?
For those of you who think I'm washed up and washed hard, well, I've got news.
It's fantastic to see the Hurricane cue in hand once again. But we've had some sad news today about a man who was closely involved in Alex's era. Our BBC colleague Dave Keir has sadly died. Dave joined BBC Sport in 1970, and he was an integral part of our coverage of snooker and many other sports for 34 years. He'll be sadly missed, and our thoughts are with Dave's family tonight. Now, if you entered this week's competition, best find out if you're a winner.
For the past week, we've been asking you to figure out who this mystery player is. The answer was, of course, C. Stephen Hendry.
And the first correct answer selected from the thousands of you who entered is Peter Battersill from Banstead in Surrey. Congratulations to you, Peter. The signed cue and £500 is on its way to you. Happy potting to you, Peter. Now, things could get just a little bit sensitive in the studio now, so Steve, if you could put your headphones on just for a minute, please. That'd be very grateful. Lovely. Okay, now we can talk about it. We're going to get a word from that ever popular, cheeky chappy world champion, the man who stuffed Steve Davis in that epic final on the black. Do you remember? Dennis Taylor.
Enter the Sport Relief Snooker Competition to win the chance of going to next year's World Snooker Championship and a fantastic Sport Relief t-shirt signed by some of snooker's greatest names. And you'll be raising money for Sport Relief at the same time. All you've got to do is answer this question.
I hear a lot of stories, I suppose they could be true. All about love.
In what year did I win the World Championship? A, was it 1975? B, was it 1985? Or C, was it 1995? Tell us your answer by calling 09065555555. Or text the word snooker, plus your full answer to 82125. Entry costs £1 plus your standard charge, with at least 70p going directly to Sport Relief. The winner will be drawn from all correct entries. So remember the prize, two tickets to the World Snooker Championships 2005, plus one night's accommodation and a Sport Relief t-shirt signed by some of the participants in the 2004 World Snooker Championship.
Okay, Steve, just find a happy place. It'll be all right. It'll be all right. Yep, Sport Relief, of course, has raised over £14 million for charities so far. And with your help, we're hoping to do an awful lot better. The big night this year is on July the 10th, and we have a special online auction for you to take part in. And the boys can show off one of our little items there. It's a beautiful print, actually, of the Crucible. And it's got umpteen world champions. They've all signed the side of that print. And we've also got a cut-down snooker table signed by all of the fellas here at the Crucible this year in the World Championship. We want you to make us a decent offer for these items. Go on, make it a big bid. And you can get online, it's bbc.co.uk/sportrelief, and go on, make it a big bid for Sport Relief. And you never know, we might even throw in Stephen John's match waistcoats. They're not using them very often these days. Sorry about that, just had to throw it in.
Nice.
Shall we get back to this match, shall we?
Oh, do you want me to talk to you?
Yeah. I did run the risk there, didn't I? Six frames all, beautifully poised. The respective coaches have been in the respective dressing rooms. What do you feel that they will have had to say to both players at this stage?
Well, I suppose Graham Dott's situation, hang on tight, and Ronnie's situation, more of the same.
John?
Graham Dott, as Steve said earlier, you know, you're six frames all in the final of the World Champions. You've got to forget the fact you're 5-0 up and just keep playing as the way you've been.
OK, change in the commentary box now as we welcome Willie Thorne and John Virgo. Good evening to you.
Good evening, Hazel. Here we are, Willie and I.
Thank you. Frame 13.
Four more frames to be
Ronnie
played
O'Sullivan
in the second
break.
Session. And Ronnie back on level terms. Graham Dott had the perfect start to the day. And he won five frames in a trot. Four frames before the end of the day. Can he stay in front or stay level? Four very big frames, in my opinion.
Yes, Graham's got his army of supporters down from Scotland, and obviously his mum's here, his wife's here. That's his mum, Susan, in the middle. Elaine on the right-hand side. Brother Billy on the left. And they must be very excited at what's going on. And Graham's frightened everybody, I'm sure, that all the people who have been, you know, lumping on the exchanges as far as the handicap's concerned. I know my pal Racing Raymond's bet on the handicap. He'd be sweating now. But Graham Dott has really played exceptionally well.
You know, when you see the family of players, it's more nerve-wracking, really, than being out there. At least when you're out there, you can do something about it. When you're sat there supporting someone, a family member, well, fingernails, a bitten, it's not really the most pleasant way to spend an evening.
Good length of cue ball, but put a red towards the corner, which I don't think Ronnie can play, as there's no avenue back into balk. The only thing that worries me so far about this match, since the sixth frame, Graham's not had a break of a 50, and he started the match so very well, scored heavily every time, and I think that's the only difference that's happened in the last few frames. When he is getting a chance, he's not winning the frame at one visit again.
caught that a bit too thin. He'll leave a red here to the left corner. We'll run it. And this time, it will be a red that the player will go for because he's not tight under the ball cushion. It's all about, can he pot this red and get good position on a colour? I just wonder if he's straight enough, if he can just stop the cue ball where the red is and play for the black in the opposite corner. Might be on. He potted the red, but he didn't hold the cue ball. With it being just off straight, it was a little bit more difficult, but as you see, he didn't pot the red in the middle of the pocket. That would have helped him hold the cue ball for the black. So now at the balk end, for the most awkward position, to leave Ronnie. They've had a treat today.
Yellow ball. Graham Dott, one.
I'm sure a lot of them came here thinking it was going to be another Ronnie O'Sullivan virtuoso performance. First five frame, it was all Ronnie wasn't playing. But he's right back in it now.
Continues to play loose shots like that, he could be out of it again very quickly. There didn't appear to be any avenue back into balk, so it was one of those reds that had to go in, it didn't. I'm just looking at the angle here and I can't see any gaps there to get back into balk.
Do you think there's a little bit of a factor, Willie, that Ronnie came into this match thinking it was a formality? Do you think he believed the publicity?
Oh, I believe so, John, absolutely. I mean, it would be very difficult not to. I mean, everybody was delighted for Graham to have played as well as he has to get to the final. He even himself had said in his interviews that that was his final against Matthew.
One.
But I've been very impressed. I was never a great advocate of Graham winning tournaments purely because he hadn't scored it heavily enough, but in the first five or six frames today, he played great. He's just slightly got into his shell. I think he must have got excited, the fact that he had Ronnie on the rack. He's certainly got a chance here to go in front again.
Seven. Eight.
I think he may be okay. As a player, when you sat in your seat and something like that happens, you always look at the player. Not the situation, because from where Ronnie was sitting, obviously, he wouldn't be able to see. But you look at the body language, and the body language seemed to tell me that you can just get through to this black. Slightly awkward. I'm not certain where the next red comes from. As you can see, can clearly get through to it.
Still slightly hampered, but if he can get enough check side, that is right hand side on this, he can
15.
Hold nicely for the black. If he plays it plain ball, he'd be very close to the black. Does look a little bit too thin, I think, at this angle to hold for it. So he may be playing with check side for pink or blue. It depends what kind of angle he feels he's got here. Yes, it's too thin, I think. So up for pink or blue.
16.
Another ball that didn't go in the middle of the pocket, and it makes a difference with the positional 22. Side of it. You look, just went in off the jaw, and that meant that the cue ball run through a bit more. He thought he'd missed it, you know. And if he decides to play this red that's below the black, this is a tough shot. This isn't easy, and he may kiss the black, so I'm not sure to be on a colour. Did kiss the black.
23.
Well, it's a long blue if he's going to keep this break going.
He's lost position on three occasions during this little break of 28. He's kept pulling out a pot. And still not perfect. In goes the blue, and the white's travelled about 6 inches too far. Now it's key here he gets on a colour properly so he can get into the bunch. Still not perfect. He's going to have to play for the red on the green spot now.
Imperative now.
33.
He plays on the cover to leave himself an angle to disturb the reds, because there's nothing possible after this red on the balk line. So it's a choice. I mean, normally you'd play up for the blue. I don't know whether he's got the angle to do that. Possibly has. He's going to play it off the
34.
Brown.
34.
That's one way of going. Just a stun shot, and that's the way he's playing it. Needs a bit of luck, but needs to get the cannon. He'll settle for that. He's on a red, and that's all you hope for, because you've opened all the other reds, so if you've got the initial red to go at, you can do the rest yourself. This is now definitely frame-winning chance.
39.
Yes, he worked very, very hard in the first 30 points of this break. And this is the first time he's had key position.
Purposely holding the pink spot. Well, I thought he was trying to hold it.
45.
Well, maybe he should have done. He's still in good position.
Okay.
Pink going on the black 46. Spot would have bothered him, but that's fine. He's one of these players as well, Willie, what impresses me, and we know because we've been through it. You know.
52.
If he does run out of position, he doesn't bother him. You know, whereas some players, they're not right on the ball as they should be. And it's all right, I'll throw some off the next shot, They're still thinking about the last one. Just needs this pink and one more red. There you see it. 60 points ahead, 67 remaining.
59.
Pop the red, go 61 points in front with only 59 left. Risky red he took on, Willie, to let Graham in for this.
Yes, well played, and that was key. We spoke about it at the beginning of this frame. Graham hasn't won a frame 60. In one visit since way back in the fourth and fifth frame. He's done it again here, just when he's back. For the first time, really, has been right against the wall when Ronnie O'Sullivan levelled. This is a very good performance, and I'm sure his family are likely to be delighted.
Yes, there's been lots of 65. Handicap betting and the like on this. One of the bets was that this match wouldn't go to the final session. Now that he's won this frame, it will be going for certain.
66. Frame's
over, they can relax for another few minutes.
Ronnie O'Sullivan has made a break of 100 in this match so far.
72.
When he made a 100 break to make it 5-1. Graham has yet to record an 100. This is a good chance.
73. 79.
This now his highest break of the match.
80.
No 100.
Graham Dott,
86 on the Graham Dott, as he's done before. When the other player comes back at him, he goes again. The family are happy. Graham Dott will be very happy. He leads once again at 7-6. Ronnie O'Sullivan sitting there. I don't know if it's 6 each. He thought he'd just got the better, but he played a shot in that last frame, Willie, that was no way it was a shot for nothing. Difficult pot near the balk cushion. Bad choice.
Well, let's just hold it here, John. I mean, there's no gap there, is there? As he's getting down to play this red, now whether he's just thinking of playing the cannon into the bunch to hold for the black, we'll let it run now, and to me it looks like he's just hit it obviously thin. But the pace he's played it, the only thing I can think of is just playing to cannon the bunch and stay on the black. And that misjudgment cost him a break of 86 and cost him the frame.
Yeah, so once again, Graham Dott laying down the gauntlet and saying, don't take liberties with me. When I did say we'll definitely have a final session, we will, unless Graham Dott wins all the remaining frames. Let's not get too one-sided. But Graham comes out to break off for frame 14.
Okay. Thank you, frame 14. Graham Dott to break.
14 now underway. Graham Dott.
Put the sweet innings
would
away
love
now,
to
please.
Win two of the remaining three frames to go into the final day in front. Ronnie once again playing the pot and the kiss to stay on the black, and that was okay that time because he'd got every chance of getting away with it, but unfortunately missed the red by so far. It's gone over the green pocket, which Graham will take on.
Yeah. 1. Twelve.
Has an angle here to bring reds into play. Whether he wants to run through or screw back, it looks like he's hitting low. Graham's done that all week. He always refuses to play with side to get top side of the blue. He's done that a few times this week. Just plays a screw back plain ball.
Yeah, I think he was hoping to do it for the left corner, but as we could see, it doesn't go. He's been pretty strong on these shots, though. Not good on the red.
18.
Well, there you go. 93% for Ronnie. 94% for Graham Dott. And that'll help his percentages. Another tremendous pot. And I think he's just 19. Got a slight angle on the blue. I'm looking at his body language. He doesn't look too happy. But from where we're sitting, I think he may just be able to force an angle. There is one red at the bottom of the cluster that will go. That's the red. Could it be very hard to generate enough pace to try and disturb things. Bit of side. Played it perfect. Delicious.
Twenty-four. Wow.
This is the last loose red. And the pack are okay because they're loose, so he can get onto the half ball black now. And the three reds are in a line. If he can hit the middle one of the three reds, if he finishes low on the black, that'll be his choice.
25.
So he's just looking now at that middle red of the three. We'll get a chance to circle that red for you in a second. So there you can see the red. He wants to hit the middle one of those three, and he wants to stun up into them, not screw. If he screws into them, he might not necessarily be on one. Played it well. Played it very well. That's open four or five reds now. Now just watch the way he hit this.
32.
And watch the red he hit, and this is exactly as he played it. There's the middle red, pushed it through. Perfect.
Graham Dott's play in the semi-final against Matthew Stevens and today has been 40. A revelation. Ronnie O'Sullivan must be wondering what's happening. This isn't the script.
41.
He's got a match on here.
Yes, Graham. is the biggest outsider to play in the World Championship final since, of course, Joe Johnson, which has been mentioned a few times on commentary back in the 80s when Joe ended up winning the title. He's just lost position again there. That's the only thing he does wrong,
46.
Graham. He's such a tenacious player, great safety game, good temperament, just loses the white a little bit too often for me.
Well, he keeps recovering it because he's potting, as we've shown you, 94%. That's been superb.
Well, that was Graham Dart, 46.
Away. But he's got a 46-point lead, and he doesn't lose many frames like this when he gets in early.
Yes, I must admit, if it came down to a tactical battle, you'd fancy Graham as good, you know, as equal as Ronnie. Obviously, on the scoring side, you would favour Ronnie. Goes without saying. But, you know, he's 7-6 in front. And deservedly so.
Through that at all, so it might just be getting to him. Well, that's a poor safety shot out from Graham, so close to the reds. That cue ball should have been on the ball cushion, not the balk line. Chance for Ronnie.
Yes, you can hear the crowd groan when Ronnie misses a long pot. They're just not to seeing him miss long pots this week. His last 10 days, virtually, I would say, above 90% of long pots Ronnie's got all week. He's missed more today than he has in the rest of the tournament. And that's because Graham Dotts been the first player to put him under real pressure since the first two rounds. Hicks and Maguire had it all his own way in the semi and the quarter.
Yes, and he's not the type of player, Graham Dott, to take any risk to give Ronnie easy opportunities to get his momentum back. It is a fact, of course, when people say, well, no one was consistent. Probably the most consistent player this season has been Ronnie O'Sullivan. Having said all that, he's only won one tournament, and even that was scraping home 9-8 against Steve Davis in the Welsh Open.
And it has to be said, from 8-5 behind, so maybe some consider fortunate to win that one.
One.
So the third time of asking, he does knock in one of those quarter ball cuts. What can he make of the chance? He can get the black into play, the blues in the open.
Four. Five.
It's a good chance.
Yeah, this is one of those situations, isn't it, John, where a 40-point lead means very little. The only thing that Graham can hope for is the red on the cushion and the pink are going to come to his rescue, because you can see Ronnie getting the next five reds and five colours.
12, 13. 20. 21.
Twixt in between.
28.
He's going to have to go up for a port colour here. Don't think he can hold for the blue. He certainly can't play for the black. Well, he's looking if he can get to the middle of the table. Must think he can. No.
29. Port
colour was a safer bet. Looking at the scoreboard, 17 points behind.
This is one of those positions where you don't play for one red, you play for two here. We're coming off the side cushion and trying to finish virtually in between blue and red, just so he's got the choice of both reds. There's the cue ball coming into that area. This is what it's all about, areas. If you're short, you're on the one on the right. If you're long, you're on the one on the left. And he's played it
32.
Virtually perfect for both.
33.
We all know how good Ronnie is left-handed. The red along the cushion, I think, is going to be played left-handed. If he gets that far in a couple of shots, the way he's played that, might not have the angle to get onto the red in a minute.
40.
Yes, the next shot's key, isn't it? This red and nicely on the black.
41.
It looks perfect. No left-handed shots here, though, and you'd think he'd want to play this left-handed. 48. This is pressure time here at the Crucible.
48.
And this is a big frame, and Ronnie knows it.
49.
Run through the side. And the fact that the brown's not on its spot makes this shot quite straightforward. He can either play it off one cushion and drop on the yellow, or he can screw up two cushions. It all depends which he feels will avail better position. 49. And there's the line. Decided to play off two cushions. That was Hobson's choice, really. He had the choice. He wishes he'd played it off one cushion now because he's short.
And that was the problem, playing it like that.
56.
You know, you have to judge the stun, whereas if we'd have followed the line that you suggested, Willie, he'd have just played it plain ball. And then all you've got to concentrate on is the pace.
Which obviously is a lot easier off one cushion, John, isn't it, rather than two. But there's a scoreboard, Ronnie's, well, one of the ones that the audience can see with similar scoreboard is for the players, is just under the commentary box position, and that's the one he had a quick glance at there, tells him he's 10 in front. The fact that the pink's safe may make him go for this. If the pink had been in open play, he wouldn't have gone for that.
Ronnie O'Sullivan, 56.
Luckily, he's got a white that's hard enough not to leave the yellow on.
When you say that, Willie, I think it will cut. It's a fine cut, and there you see. Ronnie knew how important that was. I think this yellow cuts, but whether he can manoeuvre the cue ball, may have to come all down to this end of the table and back up to get back for the green.
Yeah, the only reason I'd refuse is he can't possibly get the cue ball, I don't think, past the blue spot area if he goes in and around the back of the black. So for me, that was just a negative 2 points. I don't see the value there at all.
Two.
Well, I couldn't have played it like that. I mean, if you're going to play it, I mean, if you'd have played it harder, the cue ball would have travelled on a bit further and maybe gone near the blue spot, but I wouldn't have been bothered it being near the blue spot. The green would have still been on. Well, he's snookered. He's made a big problem for himself here.
2.
Ronnie, of course, doesn't need the pink. So green, brown and blue for 7 all. This is tough, especially if he's thinking of playing it left-handed, which it looks like he might be. Now he can reach. Just got a screw just before the middle pocket. Well played.
3.
Should be a frame winner, that one. refused the green left-handed,
seven.
Played the brown left-handed, and he's finished a little bit betwixt and between, but he only needs the blue.
But it should have been easier. Into a blind pocket for the frame. Missable.
Okay. 20 in front. Will Graham carry on, or will he concede? Graham Dott acknowledges defeat with a little nod, and the break of 56 nearly wasn't enough, but O'Sullivan will be delighted to be level again at 7-all.
And we were discussing in the studio here, the key shot in that frame appeared to be Graham Dott's attempt, and indeed the pot on the yellow.
Yes, I mean, John and Willie both agreed that the yellow was a sort of suicidal positional shot that really had no value. And if you look at the situation that Graham Dott finds himself into, it was very difficult to get back into the bulk area, wasn't it, John?
Yeah, it's a funny shot, really. It's one of them ones you can't hit it with any sort of side, go the other way round it and try and play it with running side. It's difficult for that, you won't get back up. But if you're going to play that shot, you've got to play it with a lot more pace. Mm. So that it comes off the cushion on the left-hand side and at least leaves you going towards the green. And the way he's played it there, it's just, you know, it was really a nothing shot.
Yeah, you could say he was unlucky to snooker himself behind the blue, but by doing that far away from the green, you're better off, as they said, you know, play a safety shot. There was much better safety shots, wait for a better chance.
I think another talking point from that frame is obviously the fact that Ronnie is equally adept left and right-handed. In fact, he's even said earlier in this championship that he fancies a whole season left-handed, thinks he's going to have a crack at the world title.
Yes, he said he might try and play a season left-handed and give the rest of the players a chance. Well, he's certainly a good player. It would be a good test for him to see how good he was left-handed. Okay. I'd certainly think he'd be on the tour, guaranteed.
Yeah, probably top 16, John.
No, he's very talented, isn't he? Graham Dott just needs to just tighten up a little bit on his positional play. He's just using the cue ball a couple of times, and those 30s and 40s would be 60s and 70s.
OK, 7-all.
There will definitely be a final session. 7-all.
Two frames remaining, John. You've got choice of three scores. 9-7 O'Sullivan, 9-7 Dott, or 8-all. What do you fancy?
I think on balance on the day, I think Ronnie would be very happy with 8-all. Happier than Graham Dott. The way it started for Graham and the way he's played, and he's lost a couple of frames that he maybe was favourite to win, particularly the 11th frame to me. I think Graham Dott would be disappointed to go in level. And obviously, he could still go in behind. Mistake. Catching the bump in the middle pocket. Left a chance for Ronnie. It's a long old day as well, you know. All the concentration that you use. Oh, good pot. Solid. Oh, is he overrun?
One.
Is he on the black?
Yeah.
good pot. But he was losing the cue ball. And this was Ronnie's way of trying to get that cue ball to slow up. He still hasn't decided, I don't think, whether he can just get through to this black.
Well, he's gone up the top end of the table. Maybe the black is not on. We'll have a little look at this now and see whether you think it's on, John.
No.
The master has spoken, so it's a left-handed safety shot.
Ronnie O'Sullivan won.
Graham purposely left the cue ball not on the cushion because maybe the red to the left of the black would have cut.
Refused the pot. Thought he could get a better safety shot. Certainly got a very good white. Anything near that ball cushion, and it's not going to make it easy for your opponent. I don't care if it's a pot on, it just makes it go.
Oh, is he kissing the red? He has kissed the red, and it's on to the yellow pocket.
Do you want to wait until we sort it?
The scoreboard is wrong at the moment. Ronnie's just questioning the scoreboard. We can show you there, of course, it's 7-all and 1-all. But at the minute, it's Graham Dott who thinks he's in front, but unfortunately he's not.
Well, I think he knows he's not in front. He's only been one red potted, and he didn't pot it. Must have been
settle down, please.
Snooker. Well, the referee did ask Ronnie, did he want to stop play till he sorted it out? And Ronnie went, no, I'd rather get on with it.
One.
We've got the right score.
2-0. He'd love to get rid of the red to the left of the black. I'm not sure from this angle whether he can get on into it nicely enough. He has played the choice of reds, but he will play the one at the bottom of the black if it does pot.
3.11.
The reds are perfect, really, to go into them off the black. They're not flat, so any chance he has, he can go into them.
12.
He's dead straight on this black, so it won't be this time.
11. I think the only one he can play for is the one on this top cushion. And if this is the last of the potable reds, he needs an angle off this to try and disturb something.
20.
Well played.
And this, I think, is Ronnie O'Sullivan's best shot. I think he plays this as good as any player in the game, that shot. Always it's the right red, always it's in at the right pace, always forces the cue ball through the
27.
Red.
27.
Plays that shot so well.
Yeah, and the beauty of it, Willie, as well, the way he plays it, he doesn't hit it hard, does he? He gets all of the backspin just by sheer sweetness of strike.
I think that's the key point, John, doesn't he? He gives the backspin time to work. Most players tend to hit those a bit hard, so the first 3 or 4 inches of the white when it's hit the object ball is trying to catch up with the spin, where Ronnie gets the bite straight away. And that's, I think, something that players can learn from, Ronnie and Stephen Hendry, in that kind of shot.
28.
Who's got it to do here? This will be a good shot to get onto those two reds.
Well, I'm not quite sure.
33.
Maybe there was a red in the cluster available to the right corner. There's nothing on now. 34 points is the lead. So just the safety, not a frame winning.
Ronnie O'Sullivan, 33.
And a nice return to ball. I don't know if the scoreboard in the arena is ready yet. I mean, it was at 33-0 when we last looked. I suppose it's like a broken watch. It's going to be at least right twice a day.
Yes, clearly wrong at the moment, but we can tell our viewers at home. It's 34-0. There you can see it at the bottom of our screen. Our scoreboard's correct.
Tremendous pot. Is he on a colour? He's just on the black.
One.
Well, there was good news and bad news there, wasn't it? 1 minute he was snookered, and the next minute the black just crept into the picture, and he can cut it in.
Yeah, just have a look at this. This is full speed. He's on nothing. He's on nothing. He's on the black.
Now this cut needs to be played aside to slow the white down. If he plays it plain ball, the white will end up near the brown. So he needs to screw this in with left hand side. Well, it looks like he's playing around the back with right hand side. This white will be running free. That's a poor shot. A lot easier to cut those in at the check side. A lot
one.
Easier. For somebody of Graham's class here, we're disappointed with that.
How costly a miss could that be?
One.
He won the first five frames. Every time Ronnie O'Sullivan has come back at him, he's gone again. But this miss looks as though it's going to cost him this frame. And if he loses the last one, he could finish up the day two frames behind. That 5-0 lead could be a distant
Eight.
Memory.
Nine.
You saw, got a bad contact there. Both balls jumped in the air and it took a lot of pace
16.
Out of the cue ball. Okay, he's still on this red, but he's going to have to go up for blue or bought colour. Whereas he would have been nicely on both reds for a possible chance of staying on the black.
Ronnie looks at the scoreboard, which is pointless because it's still not working, but we tell him it's 49 points in front.
It's 50 plays one.
Referee just telling him. It's 50 plays
know,
one.
I'm waiting for you to say something, you know what I mean? I'm on the shot. I know.
Well, as I say, the referee did ask Ronnie if he wanted to stop until it was sorted out, and Ronnie didn't take that option. As you can see, it's not sorted, but he's been told he's 49 points in front and there's 75 left on the table. Simple mathematics for Ronnie.
Yeah, I think
17.
What Ronnie was waiting for, Johnny, Jan Verhasp was on the phone. He said, look, I'd rather you put the phone down because I keep feeling I'm waiting for you to say something. And that's what Jan put the phone down for.
He's overrun this. And I think that's why the referee asked Ronnie.
22.
I mean, he asked him, did he want to stop? Maybe what he should have said is, Ronnie, would you please stop while we sort the score out? This red may go. He needs a red and a colour to clinch the frame. In goes the red. It looks as though he's on the green at least.
I think that's the difference with these top players. When they have a shot to nothing, they never play it as a shot to nothing. They play it as a shot to something. Now, most players that have played that
pot red and get in the good white. Ronnie didn't think do that.
Now, if he pots the green, he'll give 59 in front with 59 left. There you see it. So one red.
26.
And the frame's in his pocket.
Ronnie O'Sullivan, 34. Can see Graham? Frame conceded.
Graham Dot nods. He led 5-0. Every time Ronnie came back at him, he's gone away, but not this time. And for the first time in the match, Ronnie O'Sullivan takes the lead, 8-7.
And we were discussing here what the key shot.
Can you please check all your phones?
Davis is trying to show us that shot with a cue out the rack, John, because didn't get very far attempts, did he?
Well, as I would say, if it was his diff leave, Mick, I think he should have played safe.
Still having trouble with the scoreboard, but 7 to Ronnie O'Sullivan. The scoreboard is not fixed, is what the audience are seeing at the moment, and the players.
Yes, and just to say that Paul Collier did ask both players, did they want to stop, was it out, and they both agreed that they wanted to carry on. So the score, in effect, will be done manually by the marker.
Come round to look at the potting angle, but looking at the potting angle, I can't see how he's going to miss the black and the red back here. If he hits this wrong, this could be very costly. And he's hit it wrong. When you miss them, if you get them, you've got a chance of the shot to nothing. If you miss them, you always do that.
Yes, but it was a risky shot. And the head of regulation knows that he's left an easy starter for Ronnie.
One.
And it's just a case, how costly will that mistake be?
What a turnaround this is going to be if Ronnie can win this frame. At 5-0 behind. What amount of money he wouldn't have given to be 9-7 in front at the end of play. And that's a possible...
7.
Paul Collier is our referee. He's refereed the semi-final game. He's actually on the marking at the minute, and that's Jan Verhaas. There you can see him, and there's the paperwork that John was alluding to. Because the scoreboard's out of control, he's marking every shot. There you see it. So he will just explain to the players any time they ask. He won't shout it out unless they ask.
13. 14.
Yes, and it also puts a little bit of prep, as you say, Jan Verhaas marking it out. But normally when it goes up on the scoreboard, when a player pots a ball, immediately goes. So if he's in danger of losing the score in his
20.
Head, he can look at the scoreboard for a second opinion, if you like, just to make sure he's got the right score. Now he's on his own.
21.
And on his pedicure. Oh, he's just come a bit too far. I thought he was going to leave the perfect angle to play into the gap in between the red and pink, and that would have freed the black as well. He hasn't got that now.
Does that not tell you Ronnie likes big colours in open play? He tried it hard. No value at all in
26.
Potting this red. Well, he's looked as if he can get on the pink. The pink doesn't look on.
27.
Easy though, is it? This? Ah, oh, clean as a... Where's the pink going?
So I'm with you, John. I don't think he'll be able to pot this red when the pink goes on its spot.
33.
Ronnie's express the same. He might play with loads of left-hand side here to turn the red over. He can't see enough of it, but with left-hand side, he could straighten that red up. It's not beyond the realm he'll play this.
Yes. This is the embassy. He's looking to swerve round one, looking for a plant. Now he's looking at the right shot.
Ronnie O'Sullivan, 30.
And no, the lead is only 33, but safe.
The yellow. Well, I said he was going to say he needs a yellow to come to his rescue, but there is one to the right corner. Always going to leave one, and he can get through to this run. It might have to stand side. But to get the cue ball up the tape, probably be thinking of playing for the blue more than anything. And help.
Yeah, sure.
Choice of deciding to play with the rest. Playing the cue ball off two cushions in between yellow and blue if he's playing the green. The blue looks the easier pot as far as position is concerned, but it's a slightly tougher pot to play. Ooh, that was tight. I nearly missed that.
Six.
It was a little bit wide, wasn't it? Still had the courage, though. Fair play to Ronnie to play it left-handed.
Seven.
Another example of how good he is left-handed. So it's 40 points the lead. Does he need to go into anything, or can he find a loose red? Well, the one obviously just below the pink goes into the left corner. If he's on this, nice, pot this, you're on the black.
12.
Frame winning chance. What a turnaround.
Yeah, Stott won the first session 5-3. Looks odds on now that O'Sullivan's going to win this session 6-2 to take the lead 9-7. And Graham's got nothing to be ashamed
20.
Of here, because he's playing currently the best player in the world. And before this session started, or today's session, he'd have took 9-7 as quick as you like.
In goes the pink, 60 points in front. Needs
27.
Red and a black would do it. That put him 68 points in front, with only 67 left.
28.
To me, he went through a few little rocky moments a few frames ago, Ronnie. But Graham just couldn't keep the pressure on. And he's now looking relaxed and producing
35.
The type of form he was shown in the semi-final and quarter-final. He's had a mini-crisis, but I think he's over it.
Yeah, Graham will be disappointed tonight, because chance for chance, he's had as many good chances as Ronnie. and just not quite scored heavy enough. The first four frames of this session, of the match, he scored heavily. But as I said earlier, he'll 36. Be delighted to be still in this match after the first two sessions of this tournament. He's got nothing to be ashamed of. He's played great. Well, the pink's not gone in. Graham Dott offers his hand in congratulations after the first day's play as the crowd stand and applaud. Ronnie O'Sullivan's come back from 5-0 behind and now is in front by 2 at 9-7.
Yes, it's been an absolutely fascinating final so far. How do you feel that both men will review today's events, Steve?
Well, I think Ronnie O'Sullivan will be very proud of himself and delighted with his day's work. And I think that Graham Dott will have trouble getting to sleep thinking about that red that he missed over the yellow pocket that could have sent him into a 7-4 lead. And that's going to be tough to get over.
The commentators said that if you'd offered Graham Dott 9-7 at this point, he'd have bitten your hand off. But now that it's that situation, Johnny probably will think differently about it.
Yeah, I understand what they're saying, but when you've been 5-0 up,
yeah,
it's a different kettle of fish. But, you know, if you, I understand the point they're taking. But he's played well today, Graham Dott. Very good. But he's still behind.
Now, you fellas know exactly what the pressure of day two of this final is like. How do things change between today and tomorrow?
Every session can change, and obviously, effectively, it's another match tomorrow. They come out, but there may be a difference in the scoreline. Graham Dott will come out probably in roughly the same came out for the start of today's play. Ronnie O'Sullivan will come out in much more relaxed mode, so it could be a danger for Graham.
Were you far more nervous on day two when you came out to clinch the title, John?
I was when I woke up. I was 11-5 in front of Jimmy White, and I woke up in the morning and said to my wife, if I lose this, I'll kill myself. Which didn't go down too well with her, but thank God I didn't.
Absolutely, yeah. OK, well, let's find out what Graham Dott's coach has thought of today's events. Ray Sotomayor.
There's only one Del Boy in snooker, Derek Hill. What's your verdict on the day now?
As I said earlier, if you'd have said take 9-7, just to stick in, I said to him, just you've got to get in there, buy a raffle ticket, and then you can win the raffle. And it's like four rounds at the championship golf. On the Sunday, you're kind of come down, the last nine holes is when it happens. So if you dig in there, buy a raffle ticket. And he's bought a raffle ticket, he's still in there, he's 9-7, or he's going to be disappointed at 5-0. But I was pleased they've come off then, because Ronnie was on one. Mm. And when Ronnie's on one, I mean, I've been in his corner when he's done it, and I was quite happy that they've come off there. And we'll see what happens tomorrow. But, I mean, he's got to ask the question. I says to him, he's got to get Ronnie thinking about him. Mm. Rather than, you know, you think he's playing the greatest player on the planet. I mean, what I watched, I was at home and watched him, what he did when he destroyed Hendry. And no one's ever done that. No one's ever. He's playing the greatest player on the planet.
Surely Graham now will be thinking to himself, if you have to sort of go on the positives now, I'm giving Ronnie O'Sullivan a game and I'll give him a game again tomorrow. He must go in thinking that, surely.
That's it. I said to him, you don't want to say, oh, I'm going to win the world title. That's a big oak tree. You're going to give him a little acorn and just say, try and go out there and give Ronnie a game. Make a game of it and see what happens. Get him thinking. Get him and play his game. He's granite, that little kid. He's granite. He says, you know, he's got character. Oh, he's great. He's great.
And he's really making a name for himself. Del, thank you very much.
You're very welcome. Thank you, Ray.
Well, this MSC World Championship really gets everyone talking at this time of year, doesn't it? And throughout the last couple of weeks, we've had a whole list of celebs queuing up to ask their snooker questions.
Right, Steve, something I've always wanted to ask you in particular. What's a ferrule and what exactly is its purpose?
Well, Nicky, a ferrule is a small piece of brass tubing that fits over the end of a snooker cue and protects the snooker cue from wear and tear. And obviously, every now and again, you have to put a new tip on, you file the tip down, and all of a sudden, if you're not careful, you could mess up the end. This effectively acts as a sort of protection for the end of the cue.
Is it difficult to learn to play in front of the cameras?
Well, Peter, if you're concentrating properly, which is what you've got to do as a snooker professional, you're probably not going to see the cameras. The one exception I would say to that rule is the Crucible Theatre for the World Championships, where the cameramen are very, very tight in and very close, and sometimes actually get in the way because there's just no room there. But generally, if you're concentrating properly and your mind is on the job, you don't see the cameras at all.
Steve, another thing. Does the referee have the right to refuse a toilet break during a match? And how many times, realistically, should a player be going to the loo during a match? Because I know you've got a certain, or in the past, have had a certain tendency in that direction to, you know, nip off. And then nip off again. And then nip off again.
Well, Nicky, in my defence, I'd like to say that snooker is not an athletic game. We don't use up lots of fluid. The pressures of the World Championship, especially that first round, lots of tension and all that water we sip, well, it does add up to going out to the toilet quite often. But the referee is allowed to stop a player if he feels he's not just going out there for that reason, but perhaps to try and put his opponent off for psychological reasons. But it would be a brave referee that stopped a player in mid-flow.
I would ask him about that, but he's nipped off somewhere. Anyway, in case you missed it in the mid-session interval, we've got one more competition for you at the Crucible.
Enter the Sport Relief Snooker Competition to win the chance of going to next year's World Snooker Championship and a fantastic Sport Relief T-shirt signed by some of snooker's greatest names. And you'll be raising money for Sport Relief at the same time. All you've got to do is answer this question.
I hear a lot of stories, I suppose they could be true, all about love.
In what year did I win the World Championship? A, was it 1975, B, was it 1985, or C, was it 1995? Tell us your answer by calling 09065555555 or text the word snooker. Plus your full answer to 82125. Entry costs £1 plus your standard charge, with at least 70p going directly to Sport Relief. The winner will be drawn from all correct entries. So remember the prize, 2 tickets to the World Snooker Championships 2005 plus 1 night's accommodation and a Sport Relief T-shirt signed by some of the participants in the 2004 World Snooker Championship.
And I hope you'll enter that competition with us. Now, let's go back to 1986. Sorry about this, Steve. Joe Johnson was the lowest ranked player since Graham Dott to actually make the final. Of course, he went on to beat you in that final. But talk about the dynamics of the tension levels there. You were expected to win that one handsomely.
Yes, yes, I was. And also, Joe wasn't expected to do too much, but he'd been playing very well. And it's exactly what happened with Graham Dott this morning. He started off like a train. The difference was, I think, perhaps I sort of collapsed a bit against Joe and let Joe dominate. All of a sudden, Ronnie O'Sullivan came back from 5-0 down and started to dominate. So all of a sudden, Ronnie O'Sullivan survived that onslaught.
And of course, Graham's now going to have to break it down into bite-sized pieces tomorrow, Joe.
Yeah, it's very much so. You look at the next 4 frames, then you've got an interval. So there's little mini-sessions, if you like, Hazel. If he can come out, he'll be looking to say, can I win a 3-1, get myself back in the match on level terms.
OK, well, against all the odds, Graham Dott has made his mark in this final, but Rocket Ronnie O'Sullivan has turned things around. It's Bank Holiday Monday tomorrow, so make sure you get your garden centre visit in quickly. And we'll be back in front of the telly about 3 o'clock when we return for Session 3 of this Championship Final. Bye for now.